College Radio.
Needless to say, we're extremely disappointed in our 1-7 start. You know, I search for words to describe how we feel, what we're going through, knowing what we put into it, and the results that we've achieved.
That was General Manager John Idzik on his 2-8 New York Jets. And here, AB Conversation, we are present Anthony Carlo alongside Ben Zeno, the hero. And Ben, a special guest we have on the phone today, Greg Kohler. Greg, how are you?
Good. How's it going?
Welcome to the show, Greg.
Thank you. Thanks for having me. Appreciate it.
Oh, no problem at all. So, Greg, as a New York Jets fan, you sit here, you're coming off of a rather satisfying win. You know, the Pittsburgh Steelers, a tough team to beat at this point. They were a hot team. Has that changed any resentment in you right now for the general manager of the New York Jets?
No, because nothing's really changed. We went from 1-8 to 2-8. We're still 2-8. Right now on track to have the number 4 pick in the draft, one of the worst teams in football. The talent level on the field hasn't changed at all just because we won. I mean, it's great to get a win. Don't get me wrong, but I mean, the season's over, so no, I mean, nothing's changed.
So do you find that after the win against the Steelers, it was sort of a wake-up call, the fact that at the same point a few billboards were being raised up around MetLife reading "Fire John Idzik," you know, to remind fans that, listen, we're not out of it here. We're still in a pit that we need to get out of.
Yeah, I mean, we are, and that's why we still feel very much the way we felt 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, which is we got to get rid of this guy, and not only that, I mean, Woody's got to start with a clean slate here. We have to get rid of everyone. I mean, we're advocating we should start up at the top with the president of the Jets, because obviously he was in on all the meetings and all the interview process to bring Idzik in from the get-go. Terry Bradway, who's been with his organization since Parcells and has fired his GM and has now been an assistant for, 15 years probably. He needs to go. We need a whole restructuring of this entire organization. But Idzik, absolutely, he needs to be replaced.
Greg, how's everything? Ben here. Question.
Is it?
Were you impressed by the acquisition of Percy Harvin? Was that a move that John Idzik had to make due to the dire loss of the Jets season at the time?
No, I actually look at it as a negative. It's actually, to me, an indictment on him as a GM. I kind of went against, in my view, everything this guy's been preaching, which is built through the draft, and draft picks are sacred and, you know, worth so much. And at the time, we were 1-6. To make a deal like that, to give away a draft pick for not even a number two receiver. I mean, he's just a marginal bit player. I know he's had some decent games, but he's not like a number one receiver. Right. To give up a draft pick on a season that's lost for a guy like that, and who you're going to get rid of at the end of the year, because there's no way they're going to pay him $10.5 million next year, to me made no sense. It was purely a fan appeasement move, to kind of calm things down among the fan base, but I think it was a mistake. I think it was the silliest move.
Greg, how infuriating is it that you're dealing with, you know, as a fan, as a Jets fan, you guys, you know, you invest so much time, so much passion, you invest your money, you invest pretty much a good part, I mean, let's be honest, a good part of your life into rooting for this team. And when you have somebody that, you know, as John Idzik has been, almost not cooperating with that whole operation, not cooperating with the fans' investment to watch this team win, I mean, you have room rumors that he wanted Rex Ryan to fail so that he could take over the head coaching job. You know, all the tons of cap space he had in the offseason to try and make moves bigger than Eric Decker. I mean, do you feel this is something that, as a fan, you know, you're not going too far here? This is something that is needed to be done, you know, raising money for these billboards?
Well, I mean, this is how I'd answer it. As a fan and being a fan of this team forever, I want to win a Super Bowl. That's all I care about. That's really it, right? At the end of the day, that's what they're playing the game for, is to win a Super Bowl. But, I mean, there's an interesting dynamic here at work as well. With the introduction of a new stadium and new stadiums around the league and PSLs and asking fans to invest, in some instances, hundreds of thousands of dollars in the team to come root for the team, it's changed the dynamic. And so you have all this whole fan base investing all those tens of thousands of dollars on a team that hasn't spent every penny they can to put a decent product on the field. I mean, it's a huge indictment on the organization, on John Idzik. Granted, we don't know who was taking the money, whether he was following marching orders to not spend the money or whether he chose to. But you, as the organizations in football, they have to start listening to fans. They really do, because these fans are almost becoming shareholders by the amount of money they're being asked to dump into and dump towards these franchises with PSLs and tickets and, you know, merchandise and all the rest. So, you know, we're kind of voicing fans' frustrations right now, obviously, but to a different degree, because it's more, you know, people don't have a voice, and they've spent $50,000 and don't have a voice. And I feel like we're kind of giving a voice to those people right now.
With all the lackadaisical play of every position with the Jets, what position do you think needs to be addressed by GM during the offseason or any other trades?
Well, obviously, number one's quarterback, right?
Mm-hmm.
You live and die with a quarterback. Yep. You have a great quarterback, changes your franchise instantaneously. That has to be addressed. Obviously, our secondary has to be addressed. I have a podcast as well. Jets Will Inevitably Kill Us that I have on iTunes and Buzzsprout. But the only reason I'm giving a plug is because on that I broke down the entire roster of this team.
Right.
And it needs to be rebuilt in every position. There's no depth anywhere. Our offensive line is old. It is breaking down right before our eyes, in my opinion, and it will in 2 years. We're going to have to replace all five players, really. You name the position. Except for defensive line, we have youth there, as we all know. Every other position has to be dealt with, and that is a huge, huge proposition. And I have zero faith that John Idzik is the man for that kind of job, as he has shown.
We're talking here with Greg Kohler of FireJohnIdzik.com. He and a few friends have created this website and have been receiving donations to raise billboards reading Fire John Idzik. Greg, let me ask you this. The Jets recently responded to some of these tactics of, as you put it, giving the fans a voice with the way this team has been going. And, you know, one of those ways was flying a toy helicopter inside of their practice reading Go Jets. And another response from Rex Ryan and some of the players was stating that, quote, this crossed the line of appropriateness. Do you, Greg, have any response to those responses on the Jets organizational end?
In terms of the plane that flew over the practice, you know, we definitely support it. Look, we can voice our opinions. We're spending money, right? All these Rex Ryan and Idzik and the players, they are getting paid. They're actually, you could say, we are paying their salaries. So, you know, obviously they're going to say what they're going to say, but we're the paying fan. We're the consumer in this case. So however we need to voice our opinion, we need to voice it, and we can. I mean, it's open game, fair game. Look, if we are a competitive team, is it a distraction? Absolutely. We're 1-8. Season's over. The distraction is the front office right now and the lack of talent on the team. I mean, you know, so apparently obvious every week you watch the team play. That is the distraction of this team. It's not a plane, you know, flying over a practice.
What's the feeling about the fact that Geno Smith is no longer starting anymore, and the fact that, you know, they have Michael Vick in there, and, you know, you can look at this as if this team was actually trying to win, why not go with Michael Vick from day one, and Geno Smith, you know, he should be in there at this point trying to show this organization what else this kid can offer. I mean, do you agree with that, you know, the fact that Michael Vick is the starter right now?
To a degree, I do think he probably should have started coming out of camp if there was a so-called competition, which Idzik, you know, came in 2 years ago preaching about a competition. Clearly there was no competition there. They wanted Geno from the get-go. I do think we would have possibly have won more games, although let us all remember Michael Vick is also a turnover machine, so that's not to say he wouldn't have been committing the same type of turnovers that Geno Smith was. At this point in the season, I don't really see the point of playing Vick. I don't see what a game, like what how the organization wins by winning possibly two or three games right now.
Right.
The last thing we need, because what people have to remember is, you don't want to lose out for a draft pick. That's silly. Yeah, for a first round, number four pick, I get it. But then in the second round, you're the fourth pick. In the third round, you're the fourth pick. Every round thereafter, you have a high pick in that round. That is meaningful. I think that's more meaningful than letting Vic play out the string. You might as well throw Matt Sims out there for a game or two just to see if he can play, just because guys can't practice. I mean, some guys don't practice well. It doesn't mean they don't play well from Sunday.
Right.
Just to see if you got a backup with him. If you don't, then you might as well move on from him as well.
Right. So, Greg, with this website, you are gaining something good out of this as well. Not only are you giving the Jets fans a voice, but I also saw on the website that you guys are donating a portion of this to some children's hospitals. Is that correct, Greg?
Absolutely. We definitely are. The Cincinnati and Philadelphia Children's Hospital for pediatric cancer care and research.
That's very nice. And in order to go on to this website, all you have to do is visit firejohnidzik.com. And aside from taking the donations for the billboards and the other efforts to wake up this Jets organization, the creators of this website are also donating for a good cause with children's cancer. I want to thank you so much for joining us today, Greg. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, Greg.
Yeah, thanks for having me, guys. I appreciate it.
And good luck with the rest of your...